scissors, balloons, clay. Whoa.
Mr. C, WunderSTEM Hotline, how may I help you? Oh, hi. Yeah. Take a deep breath. Take a deep breath. Oh, yes. Yes, speaking of breaths, I know the perfect person. Yep. As usual, you can hop online and check out the entire video afterwards. All right. Bye. That was Riley, and she was wondering what kind of person works with lungs. Well, I know the perfect job and the perfect person to talk to. His name is Garrett Robinson. He's a respiratory therapist with Premier Health in Dayton, Ohio. He knows everything about lungs and how to help people breathe better, and that's what his job's all about. I think we should go check it out, don't you think?
My name is Garrett Robinson. I am a registered respiratory therapist here at Premier Health, and I've been doing this for about 2 years now. So a respiratory therapist is a medical professional that assists patients with aspects of pulmonary diseases and processes. So your COPDers, people with pneumonia, things like that. We assist in giving them different kinds of treatments that help open up their lungs, clear their clear secretions, junk that's stuck in their lungs. And we also run machines that help patients breathe. Ventilators, when a patient gets put on life support, we manage that machine and work to help liberate them from it. As grim as it can sometimes sound, working with like the ventilators, working with life support, I work in the ICU mainly, and that's what I love most about this job is being there in those most critical moments. And so getting to work with that, but also just working with a really good team of people. You know, when it comes to the medical field, especially in those critical moments with patients, there is no judgment. There's no, oh, we're not friends, we don't get along. Like, everyone just, it's weird to watch how everyone just kind of unites into like this one single mission, and that's to like keep this patient, you know, alive or save them, get them healthy, get them back on track. And it's incredible to work with some of these other people that are so incredibly intelligent. And it's one of those fields that you will never ever master. You will never perfect being a respiratory therapist. It's an unending goal because medicine is evolving every single day, but you will learn something every day you come to work, every day. All right. Slightly deeper than normal. As with every patient you go in, every time you go to assess a patient, you listen to their lungs. So that can help you. You listen to various sections of their lungs because your lungs have multiple lobes within them. And you're basically listening to hear any kind of audible abnormalities, things that aren't right with it. You can hear, if someone has a bunch of junk secretions, you can hear that rattling in their lungs when you listen to it. If they're an asthmatic that's having a severe asthma attack, you can hear what's called wheezing, which basically sounds kind of like a whale in the ocean. It's this weird little sound, and it helps us decide, you know, a patient could be short of breath, but why are they short of breath? Using your stethoscope is one of those diagnostic tools that help you kind of differentiate, okay, it's this instead of that.
Good and clear.
Nice.
So one thing that I'm sure anyone that's ever been to a hospital is probably familiar with, whether they realize it or not, is something called an incentive spirometer. It doesn't involve any kind of medications. It's just basically this little cylinder, and it has a little tube that you breathe, and you basically, you'll inhale slowly, and it'll bring this little lever, like a little paddle thing. It'll kind of float it up, and it has numbers, and it'll kind of tell us like how much capacity you have to breathe in, and we use that to help show how deep someone can breathe, to help promote the deep breathing. When you're in the hospital, you know, you're laying in bed, just like if you were at home, the less you use your lungs, the less you work with them, the weaker they get. And so when you lay in the hospital and you're not breathing as deep, you're hurting, you're in pain, things like that, that's how disease processes like pneumonia happen, because you're not deep, breathing deep enough, and things get, you know, into your lungs and cause infection. So that helps promote, that device helps promote the deep breathing to keep your lungs fully open. It's like an exercise for your lungs. My home unit is our heart and vascular ICU, which is where patients who undergo open heart surgery, that's where they go to recover initially, along with We also get overflows of other kinds of ICU patients, but I just love the ICU in general. I love trauma. I love, you know, I guess the bloodier, the gorier, the better for me. I've heard people call me an ambulance chaser. Wherever the action is, I want to be. And I think what I love most about it is the adrenaline rush of how severe it can be in the moment. You have to make, you know, critical thinking as, you know, working on an ICU, a critical care unit, it's imperative. You have to be able to think quickly on your feet and make decisions in an instant that can have effects on this patient. And I love being with the sickest of the sick because I really feel like I can make a difference and work with some of these other incredible health professionals and getting them better and seeing them, you know, leave the hospital. So one of the most common things we give here is a nebulized breathing treatment, which is basically where we take a mask and something called a nebulizer, which essentially turns a liquid into a gas. And we would put medications, whether it be albuterol, which is like a bronchodilator. It helps open your lungs up. That's what a lot of asthmatics take to help open their lungs when they get tight from the asthma. We can give what's called hypertonic saline, which is essentially salt water that helps mobilize secretions so that the patient can cough them out if they're getting stuck in the lungs. And we put that medicine in the nebulizer and attach it to an oxygen source within the room. And it's usually, there's a little, either a little mouthpiece, or sometimes when patients are too weak or they're, you know, they're sleepy, they're not able to actually hold the nebulizer themselves, we can also utilize a mask attachment that we can put onto it. And you turn the oxygen flow on, and as the oxygen runs through, it turns that liquid into like a mist that the patient breathes in, and then they can get that drug into their airways and help with whatever we're trying to help with at the given moment.
And this is not medicine for everybody who's watching.
Yes, this is just salt water.
It's fogging up my glasses.
Yeah.
And how long would someone do this typically?
These nebulizers, it depends on the nebulizers. These nebulizers we have here, generally about 5-6 minutes, it'll finish treatment. When I give you the treatment, a real medicine treatment, it would have this saline in it. It's basically kind of diluted medicine. So it would have a small portion of actual medicine mixed with saline to take. Because if you have a regular albuterol treatment, it's very, very little, just a few drops of pure, like actual albuterol. The rest is saline mixed into it to kind of dilute it down and be able to nebulize it. And we also have another device called a PEP device. And that is also used to help clear secretions. So basically when you breathe into it, it doesn't involve any medication. You'll breathe into it. There's a little valve in there that kind of flaps back and forth, and it vibrates the air that goes through your lungs. And as it vibrates the air, it helps shake loose secretions that might be in your lungs that you can help cough them out. All right, so this is the Arabica. This is our PEP device. What I'm gonna have you do is I'm gonna have you seal your lips tight around the mouthpiece, and you're just gonna exhale slowly into it for about 10 breaths. This is just gonna simulate a treatment I would give to help remove secretions from the lungs, or help incite a cough to remove secretions from the lungs.
So I'm just breathing normally into this?
Correct.
All right. 10 times?
Yes, nice slow breaths. And you can breathe into it. You don't have to break the seal on your lips if you don't want. Correct. And also, if you can, and you're doing a good job, keep your cheeks tight. Don't let them flutter when you do it. Perfect. You feel it moving in your chest? Probably an odd sensation. Good job.
I feel like I'm drooling all over myself.
Then normally we would do three sets of 10.
That's building my lung strength back?
No, this is just vibrating the air to help break up secretions. So if you have like a pneumonia or some kind of process where you have secretions, junk in your lungs, that vibration helps you break it up and inside a cough.
Is there anything inside of that? Because I heard like, or is that just
breathing? Yeah, there's, so you can actually... It's got like a little valve in there that flutters back and forth.
There's no liquid or anything.
No. Nope. It's just your breath. That's
it. Wow. So that all that sound and things, that flutter, literally this doing its job.
A little flutter device, right.
That's a little cool piece of technology.
Mm-hmm. When it comes to something like nursing, you know, nurses have to have such a massive knowledge base of the body. They have to know so many things. And I also like the fact with respiratory that I got to focus on one portion of the body and just know it really, really well. And quite honestly, it's something that not a lot of people do. It's not a very well-known job field, I think, you know. And so I thought it was something different, something a little specialized I could get into. So I went for it. If I had to go back and talk to 10-year-old Garrett about my future here as a therapist, I would tell him to keep an open mind. Don't get so attached to what's quote unquote right and wrong in school and realize that when you go out into the real world, some things change. Policies change, hospital things change. Have an open mind and always be willing to learn because there's an endless amount of knowledge to attain. I would tell him that he would be looking forward to a job where he can help people in their most vulnerable moments. He can be there at those most critical times and work with the most incredibly intelligent coworkers and colleagues to help someone when they need it most, to kind of, you know, bring them back from the brink. And I think I would tell him that he would get such immense satisfaction from doing that every day.
What an amazing job and special career. Garrett gets to work with people and helps them breathe better each and every day. I think it would be so much fun to do that. And speaking of breathing and lungs, check this out. I made my own lung, and when I pull down on the diaphragm, the blue part, it inflates. And when I push back up, it deflates, just like I'm breathing. How cool is that? Hey, you can build one of these too. Just hop online and download the activity sheet and follow along. And I'm also wondering, could you see yourself doing a job like this and helping people as a respiratory therapist? And I'm also wondering, will you join us for another episode of WunderSTEM as we check out amazing new careers? I sure hope so. See ya.